So let's get started. So in the last class, I think we have introduced the various mechanical tests, and then this is a specific test, uniaxial tension test, that you probably are familiar already, but nevertheless we will see when you have the stress strain diagram obtained through this uniaxial tension test and how do we go about interpreting the data. Okay, so here you have a typical screw driven UTM. So and here this is your specimen and loaded between two cross heads, and you have a load cell here which actually measures the load that you are applying, and then you move this guy is fixed and you move this cross head down so as to pull the specimen, right? So we also use something called an extensometer, or in other words strain gauge, to actually measure the deformation precisely. Many times people might actually use the cross head movement as the deformation, but then it is not going to be precise because there is going to be some losses in the frictional interaction between the cross head as well as the screws, and also the stiffness of the machine. And hence in order to measure, and also you have a gripping here and there may be some slip in the grips and so on. So to avoid all these errors into your measurement, you actually have a strain gauge which is an extensometer which is connected between two points, typically in the gauge section of the specimen, so that you can actually measure what is the extension, right? And this is a typical tension specimen, and it's cylindrical in shape, but you also have tension specimens which are flat specimens, and these are called dog bone kind of specimens, wherein you have the central region which is called gauge section having low reduced cross section compared to the area where we grip the specimen using the cross head, right? So you will have grippers. Depending upon the experiment that you want to do, you may have to change the grippers, and depending on the geometry of the specimen, if it is a cylindrical specimen, then the grippers have to be of different kind as compared to when you have a flat specimen. Okay, so you need to buy these additional grippers as and when you want to change the geometry of the specimen that you want to test. And similarly, the same, it is called universal tension test or universal testing machine because you can do other tests as well, not only a tension test, but you can also do a compression test. If you have a fixture, appropriate fixture, you can do a shear test, and you also can do 3-point bending. All that you need to do is, the machine is the same, all that you will change is the fixture that's necessary for a particular kind of experiment, and that is why it is called UTM. Okay, and the critical thing is that whenever we are doing a test, for instance a tensile test, to measure the mechanical properties of the material, you need to ensure that the specimen is prepared according to certain standards. So this particular society called American Society for Testing of Materials, ASTM, has come up with several standards for each and every kind of a test. For instance, if you want to do a tension test on metals, okay, so ASTM E8 is the standard that one needs to use. So you need to go to ASTM standards and see the specimen specifications and prepare your specimen according to those specifications. So the thickness, length, the ratios, if at all it is a cylindrical specimen, what should be the diameter of my gauge section and so on, should be prepared according to ASTM standards, so that you can actually corroborate your results with the results available in the literature. Okay, so everybody who does this test will use ASTM standards always. And sometimes it may be, if you are working with a new kind of a material, it is probably not possible for you to make specimens according to ASTM standards. Then if you are doing so, when you are reporting your results, you need to mention what is your specimen size if it is not according to ASTM standards, because the results are going to be different, and then somebody who is interpreting your results should be aware of the fact that there is a change in placement geometry. Okay, otherwise you will have conflicting opinions on the result. So it's extremely important that the specimen geometry be specified clearly. Okay, all right. So when you do this test, you probably have seen the load displacement curve, and from there you can actually generate the stress strain curve. And I'm showing individual parts of the stress strain curve, and later we will show the complete stress strain curve. So when you are loading the system initially, you are, for instance, if you have done this experiment on metal such as mild steel, you would have seen a linear elastic response. On the x-axis you have strain, and y-axis you have stress. Okay, in so stress you have to say what are the units, typically megapascals, and strain units. What are the units of strain? It does not have units, because the definition of strain is change in length per unit original length, right? Depending upon how you are defining your strain. So typically this is mentioned as strain, or sometimes you also can mention this as a percentage. Both are possible. Okay. So the initial response of the material is going to be elastic. Before you actually going to deform the material elastically, you have to elastically deform the material, right? That's what you will see. What is the meaning of elastic deformation? You are basically stretching the bonds between the atoms, right? So in this region, you have your stress and strain proportional to each other, right? So here you have a linear elastic response, meaning the stress is proportional to strain. There is a linear relation between those two things, and this is your loading direction. And within the elastic regime, if you are unloading the specimen, it goes back along the same path, right? So the unloading direction is also the same, and the slope of this stress strain curve is what is called elastic modulus, or Young's modulus of elasticity. So the E that we actually specify as a mechanical property is coming from the elastic regime of your uniaxial tension. Okay. And as we know, this elastic deformation is completely recoverable. It is non-permanent deformation. So as soon as you unload, you will go back to your original configuration, meaning zero stress state and zero strain. You will not see that the material is actually deformed sometimes by later. Right? So the constitutive response that relates stress to strain in this regime is called Hooke's law, is represented as sigma equal to E times epsilon, because it's a linear elastic material. If it is non-linear elastic material, then this part will not be a linear fit, but it will be a non-linear curve, and then your elastic modulus keeps on changing as you continue the loading. Right? You will not have constant elastic modulus, but you will have varying elastic modulus during the deformation, and that is typically several times we observe such a behavior in elastomers and polymers, right? All right. So this is a typical nonlinear elastic response, wherein your slope of the stress strain curve keeps on evolving. So there are two ways to define the instantaneous elastic modulus. One is what you call tangent modulus. So if you are at a point, given point, you draw the tangent to the line, to the curve at that point, and the slope of the tangent is called tangent modulus. And sometimes what you do is you can actually calculate secant modulus. So you connect the line from origin to the point at which you actually want to find the slope, and then the slope of that line is your secant modulus. And this is usually preferred, but this is simpler, right? Because you don't have to do any differentiation here. So computationally it is less expensive, but this is more expensive, but this is more accurate. Tangent modulus is more accurate. Okay. And so what is this elastic deformation? Elastic deformation is actually nothing but the stretching of the bond. So the interatomic spacing you are increasing as you are doing elastic deformation, but you are not breaking the bond. Okay. So this is the force separation response that you would have studied in your interatomic bonding module, and from there you can actually say that your elastic modulus is a measure of resistance to separation of external energy. Okay? So in other words, the stiffness of your stress strain curve, which is the resistance to separation of atoms which are adjacent to each other when you are applying tension. Okay? So typically for materials, the modulus of elasticity is very little affected, slightly affected by alloying, heat treatment, cold work. It is not significantly affected, little bit only changes, and it really depends on the nature of atomic bonding in the material. As long as by doing these processes, if you are not changing the nature of atomic bonding, you are not going to change the elastic modulus. Okay? But as a function of temperature, what happens? As a function of as you increase the temperature of the material, what happens to the elastic modulus? The elastic modulus changes, right? So that is because we have seen this interatomic separation, force separation law as a function of temperature is going to change, and as a result, the slope of this curve is going to change as you increase the temperature, and hence you would see a difference in elastic modulus. And many times within certain range of temperatures you don't see much of a change of elastic modulus, but beyond at very high temperatures you start seeing the effect of temperature on elastic modulus. And hence when you are analyzing the materials, you should know what is the operating temperature, and depending on the operating temperature you should decide whether you want to have the effect of temperature included in the elastic deformation or not. Otherwise you will be making a mistake in calculating the stress state of the material within elastic deformation. Okay? And then you have another property called anelasticity, which is nothing but a time dependent elasticity. So what is the meaning of this? So basically when you are applying stress on a material, you apply a load in the case of elastic deformation. And if you are holding that particular load, then strain remains constant unless you further increase the stress, right? But in the case of anelasticity, even after maintaining the stress constant, you may observe some strain continue. Okay? So as a function of time, this material actually starts to deform even though you are not increasing the magnitude of the stress that is applied. And at the same time, in the case of elastic deformation, the moment you unload the specimen, it comes back to its original configuration immediately. There is no time factor involved here. Whereas in these kind of anelastic materials, you unload the specimen to zero stress, but then the specimen takes some time to come back to its original configuration. It will come back, but it may not come back immediately. So that means there is a time factor involved. So after some time it will come back. So immediately if you would measure, you might see that there is some plastic deformation, or there is some permanent deformation. But that permanent deformation slowly reduces as you wait for longer time. Okay? For metals, usually it is negligible. But for polymers, this is one of the important deformation. So that's about one of the important mechanical properties called elastic modulus of the material. How do you go about measuring this elastic modulus? For linear elastic materials, it's going to be constant. For non-linear elastic materials, it will be a function of stress state or strain that you have imported in the material. And the next important property of the materials that we need to focus on is Poisson's ratio. So what is this Poisson's ratio? If you are deforming a material normally in one direction, then let's say it is getting elongated, in the lateral direction it contracts. Why does it contract? In one direction you are elongating, in the lateral direction the material has to contract. That means in this direction if the strain is positive, in the lateral directions the strain will be negative. Why does it have to be negative? Because volume has to be constant, right? So for volume constancy, you are not adding any additional volume. So so the Poisson's ratio is defined as negative of lateral strain by longitudinal strain. So if you are taking the specimen and you are loading the guy in the z direction, right, epsilon z is the longitudinal strain and the lateral strain will be epsilon x or epsilon y, right. So you can define your Poisson's ratio actually as nu xz and nu xy, that is minus epsilon x by epsilon z, that is minus epsilon y by epsilon z. But typically for isotropic materials, these two values are gonna be same. Okay, so nu is defined for an isotropic material, you can simply say lateral strain by longitudinal strain, but if it is an anisotropic material, it is not going to be a single number. It depends on the direction in which you are actually measuring. Okay, so the most important thing to remember is that there is a negative sign here, and hence your Poisson's ratio will always be positive. Right? So theoretically, the Poisson's ratio range for isotropic materials is 0.25 to 0.5, and for metals 0.25 to 0.32. But you can actually show that by using energy arguments, the Poisson's ratio can be a max, at most it can be plus 0.5, and it can actually go to negative 1. So it can be actually between minus 1 less than or equal to epsilon less than or equal to 0.5. This is, sorry, not epsilon. That is the range of Poisson's ratio values that you can obtain theoretically. But what is the meaning of, we said, we just now discussed, when you are pulling a guy in this direction, then what should happen in the lateral direction? It should contract, right? As a result, you can only conceive a positive Poisson's ratio. So what do you mean by negative Poisson's ratio? When you are pulling the guy in this direction, instead of contracting in the lateral direction, the material expands, then such a material will have negative Poisson. So normally crystalline materials, you will not observe this negative Poisson. Always you are somewhere. That is why this is the range that we need to go. But there are new class of materials called oxidic materials, which show lateral expansion due to longitudinal expansion. So when you are applying tension in this direction, in these materials you observe also expansion in the lateral direction. That means your Poisson's ratio is negative. Such materials are called metamaterials. They are general class of metamaterials. Oxidic materials are a subset of the big class of metamaterials. That's the recent revolution in terms of material design. Okay? So what can they offer? They can offer tremendous new possibilities, okay, in terms of mechanical deformation, because people have, for instance, several biomedical devices, which, for instance, the stents that you send into arteries, you want to actually pull them. At the same, when you are pulling them, you want them to expand later, because so that they can fit in the artery. So that kind of structures can actually be now designed as a reality. Okay, it was not possible say 20 years ago, but today we can very well nicely design these structures from mechanical engineering point of view. But they are, you also have other interesting metamaterials. So you see this guy, this is what is called invisibility cloak. So you can see this guy is wearing a shirt. You must have seen this in Harry Potter, right? So it is not a science fiction anymore. People have actually demonstrated invisibility. That means that there is basically optical cloak. So you play with your refractive index, right? So the fact that you are able to see me standing here is because the light rays that are falling on me are reflected back. and as a result you are able to see me, otherwise you will not feel my existence, right? What if I can, what if I block the reflection of light wave from my side, right? Or I will, rather than reflecting in that direction, I will send all the light that is falling on me in these ways, and then it is not actually going and hitting in your eyes, right? And hence you think that I am not here, although I am here. Then, so similarly, you see this guy. This is normal, right? The left hand side is normal. The right hand side is not normal. So you are playing with your refractive index of the material, and you make your negative refractive index, and then you actually can show something which is actually not broken, as if it is two different pieces, right? So this is, people have actually theorized these things, optical cloaking and all, quite some time ago, but now people are able to make design materials which can change refractive. Now people are talking about acoustic cloaking. What is the meaning of that? So suppose you want to have a window, so something, I don't know, it is not yet a reality today. I want that window, I want it to be open because I want the air to flow in, but I don't want to hear the noise outside. Is it possible? Right? What I want is basically I want to filter out certain frequencies, but that means the noise, that is whatever noise that I am going to have, should not be coming through the window, but I only want air. Similarly, there are infinite number of possibilities if you can think about new kinds of material. Okay? All these things are today possible, and one can actually make several things which are science fiction in your Harry Potter movies or in several Indian mythology. We would have thought about them as science fiction, but today you can actually make them a reality. All right. So we have discussed about elastic constants E. Elastic modulus, mu bosons ratio, right? This is only true for isotropic materials. You just need to describe their elastic response. You only need two constants for an isotropic material to describe the elastic response. But if it is an anisotropic material, you will require more number of constants, and hence you need to do more experiments. So for isotropic material, you can actually measure the bosons ratio and elastic modulus using how many experiments? How many experiments do you need? Have you tried measuring Poisson's ratio of your mild steel specimen? You didn't try? You can actually try, right? Because you have measured the longitudinal strain, and at the same time you can put a strain gauge in the opposite direction, and then you would have measured the lateral strain, isn't it? So the elastic modulus and Poisson's ratio could have been measured at the same in one single, right? So you also have the relation between other elastic constants like shear modulus G, bulk modulus K. So shear modulus relates shear strains with shear stress, right? Tau is shear stress, gamma is shear strain, and G is your shear modulus. And bulk modulus connects what? Pressure and volume, right? All right. So you can always write a relation between these things, and I am not going to derive these relations, but I will leave it to your work so that you can derive them and then be happy about it. Okay. And for most materials, your Poisson's ratio is 0.25 or 0.3, and hence the relation between G and E is approximately 0.4. You just plug in U equal to 0.25 to 0.3, then you will have G and E are related, something like that. For, as I mentioned, for anisotropic materials, several elastic constants exist. Theoretically, you need 81 elastic constants, and then you can actually show that by using certain arguments, 21 are enough, and then using symmetry arguments, eventually you will be able to show that for an isotropic material, just 2 are enough. That is, that comes out to be E. Otherwise, if it is a fully anisotropic material, theoretically you will see that 81, but you can actually reduce for a anisotropic material, you will see probably in this class, at some point of time, we will see how many constants are. Okay.